Hello everyone, welcome to the session 11 of Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation Workshop. In the previous 2 weeks, we learned about how to annotate variants based on literature-based evidence. We also learned how to do this effectively step by step. Today, we are going to learn about a few tips and tricks for effective literature search based on ACMG guidelines. The literature-based evidences that we are looking for are the functional studies, where the clinical consequence of the variant can be interpreted on the basis of incorporating the variant in cell lines or on any of the model organisms. We are also interested in looking at case reports which show the segregation of the variant in normal individuals and symptomatic members of the family. Association studies which show the association of the variant and the disease are also of importance to us. Lastly, we are looking at the molecular characterization of the variant. We are interested in understanding if there are two variants in a compound heterozygous form in a symptomatic individual. We want to understand whether the variant is present in the cis form, that is, both the variants are present on the same allele, or if both the variants are present on different alleles. On the basis of these evidences and few others, we will discuss in further weeks. We would be able to understand the clinical consequence of the variant, whether the evidences classify it as benign or pathogenic. We will go about doing this by mining several literature-based databases such as Google Scholar, PubMed, PMC, ClinVar, and Omni. As discussed in the previous week, we need to use several resources at the same time to retrieve all the publications to classify the variants correctly. These resources can be mined effectively with the use of good search terms. This can be done with the help of quotation marks in the search box. The use of quotation marks in the search will improve the quality of the search hits and also make it very specific. This can be enhanced further by using certain Boolean operators such as the AND operator and the OR operator. One also needs to keep in mind that the HGVS nomenclature is not followed very strictly, and using these search combinations is required so that we can mine the literature correctly. One also needs to remember that we should only search with the positions as well, because sometimes the variant positions are written correctly while the changes are written in different formats. Another important point that one needs to remember is that sometimes there are multiple transcripts of a gene, and we need to now search for each one of them, because the cDNA positions and the protein positions might vary slightly. In these cases, one needs to search using each one of these changes one by one patiently. Different publications might report the same variant with reference to different IDs, due to which the protein and the cDNA position might vary slightly. But in the end, they are all referring to the same variant. Hence, we need to patiently search using each and every protein change and cDNA change. Let us look at a few examples on how the representation of the variant might change even when the same variant is being referred to. In case of cDNA positions, sometimes there might be a space which can get added between the position and the nucleotide change. In case of protein position, sometimes three-letter amino acid codes are used instead of single-letter amino acid codes. This might result in skipping of some articles during the literature search. In case of nonsense change, sometimes there is a TER word or a stop word added instead of the X, which is the single-letter representation of a stop codon. Even in case of deletions, there can be several formats for representing the same variant. In case of intronic variants, sometimes IVS nomenclature is used while reporting. Hence, it is very important to use several ways to search and mine the literature in order to retrieve all the relevant articles. Let us now look at some of the common problems that one could face as a beginner while going through the literature. The first and the most important issue that one faces is that there are a huge number of literature-based hits retrieved on mining. Now, one needs to quickly figure out if the publication or report is really worth the time of a thorough read. This can be done by simply searching with the help of the position and reading the sentences of the search hits only where the variant is present. In this way, only one would have to read only a few sentences. On reading just those sentences where the variant is present, one can easily figure out if the paper is worth a thorough read. Sometimes, but very rarely, a gene might have alternate names, and it would be useful to know if the gene has any alternate names, because certain publications might use these alternate names instead of the commonly used names that are reported. One should also know that there are several ways to report a variant, and hence this forces us to use several search term combinations. One major problem is to understand whether the experimental evidence is sufficient to classify this variant, and I think there is a lot of confusion around this. I hope by the end of this lecture we will learn how to use the literature or experimental evidence to sufficiently classify the variant with confidence. The basic workflow to mine the literature evidences starts with the VCF file. This VCF file can be annotated with the help of VEP. VEP is an online tool which we learned about in the previous lecture. VEP helps us to retrieve the gene name, the cDNA change, the protein change and position, and it also provides us with the dBSNP ID. Along with which, it also provides us with the global allele frequencies and other computational predictions. These details can then be used to mine the literature-based evidences.
To start annotating the variants, the first thing that we need is the VCF file, which we have already studied about in the previous lectures. The VCF file has 8 mandatory columns, which are chromosome number, position, ID, reference base, alternate base, quality score, filter, and info. This VCF file will be uploaded to the VEP server, and then we will retrieve 4 things that are of prime importance to us. So what are these 4 things, and how are they required to mine the publications? The first thing that we will need is the gene name, along with which we will need the cDNA position, we will need the protein change, and we will need the dBSNP or the RSID. With this, we will mine the publications. The first step would be, after doing VEP, is that we take the gene name, we take the protein position, and we search at Google Scholar, PubMed, and PMC. And after this search, we will retrieve maximum number of publications as much as we can with this search, and read through each one of them and try to understand which of them are important to us and which are not. The next thing that we will do is use the gene name along with the cDNA position. Sometimes variants are reported only in the format of cDNA and the protein changes are not given. We also need to use the cDNA change to mine publications. So just like we did for the protein change, we will mine at Google Scholar, PubMed, and PMC. The last thing that we need to do is mine using RSID. So using RSID, we will hit at Google Scholar, PubMed, PMC, and along with which we will also look at ClinVar and OMIM. So ClinVar and OMIM provides accurate searching with the help of RSID. Hence, we will use RSID for searching at ClinVar and OMIM. So after everything, what are we looking for in these publications? So we are looking for functional studies, and on the basis of functional studies, we will assign 2 ACMG attributes, that is PS3 and BS3. Let us look at what are these attributes. So basically, when we are looking at any functional assay, we want to understand if there is a difference between the mutant phenotype and the wild type phenotype after the variant is introduced or in the presence of the variant. So if there is a significant difference in the mutant phenotype as compared to the wild type, we can assign the PS3 attribute. And if there is no significant difference in the mutant phenotype as compared to the wild type, then we can assign the BS3 attribute. So one of the very simple assays that are present in the literature usually are the biochemical assay, which measure the levels of any metabolite, protein, or mRNA, or any other biomolecule. And with the help of these levels in healthy and patients, we can then compare if there is any significant difference between the levels in the healthy individual and patients. So we are looking at such levels and such comparisons in literature evidences. Let us look at one example as to how we will go about doing and searching for such evidences. So I have picked up one variant which was provided in the assignment given in the previous week. And I have annotated the variant using VEP. After annotation, VEP has assigned the gene name of NLRP3. It has also identified that these are the cDNA changes on the basis of the NMIDs, and this is the protein change. So as you can observe, in this particular variant, there are multiple NMIDs or transcripts, and which is why there are multiple cDNA changes and protein positions. What we will do is we will search one by one using each one of them, and we will not miss any of them. Lastly, this is the RSID of that particular variant. So let us first mine through literature and try to understand what is the importance of this variant. So first we will use the protein position. So as you can see, after searching through Google Scholar, I have identified 7 articles. So I will read through each of these articles one by one. In PubMed, after mining, there were known results that were found. In PMC, there were 2 articles. And these 2 articles are also present here. The second article is probably not present there. So I will open the second article. So let us mine through each of these publications. So as you can see, in the first publication, and this publication is freely provided by Unpaywall. When the lock is open and it is green, then it means that Unpaywall has a free access to this particular article. And if the lock is gray, then Unpaywall does not have free access to this particular article. What I will do is I will not read the entire publication. Instead, I will just search for the protein change that we are interested in. So now in the third search, I can see that this particular mutation was evaluated, monocytes were obtained, and a pattern of secretion was assessed using ELISA, which means there is a level of metabolite or IL-1 beta that was measured. And now we need to know what was the difference in between the healthy people and the patients. So in the results, there is one sentence which says that as compared to the healthy controls, the patient displayed enhanced and delayed IL beta secretion. So which means that I can assign the attribute of PS3 to this particular variant. So which is why I have assigned the attribute of PS3 to this particular variant. Now let us look at other publications that are available. So for ease of access, I have just downloaded all these articles and kept ready. So now let us look at each article. So the first article we already annotated. Now the next article is the clinical characteristics. So let us open this particular article. Now, since this is a big article, now I'm not going to read through the entire thing. I will only look for I313V variant. As you can see, this is only present in one place. So they say that on the other hand, other variants such as characterized by low penetrance and the clinical effect is debated. This is the only thing that is mentioned about this particular variant in this particular article, which is the second link. And that is why I will choose to ignore this particular article. The next article is about the mast cell. So let us open that article. So I have obtained a full text of this particular article. Now I will search through it. So here also, there is only one hit, and what they are saying is they found 4 patients and 2 patients with CAPS and 1 with NLRP3 mutation, and they observed some phenotype. No other detail is mentioned in this particular article, so I will choose to ignore this particular article. The third article, let us now look at the third article. So this is the third article. I will not read through it. So this is present in two places. One place, just the details of that variant is given. And in the other place, there are some phenotypes that are given, but there are no other details. So I will choose to ignore this article. Lastly, this is the last article that is present. So let us go through that article. So there is a table with symptoms in this particular article, and there is no other detail. Hence, we cannot assign any of the ACMG attributes on the basis of this particular article. So we will choose to ignore it. And then this is the last article. So in this way, we can browse through all the articles and try to understand if there is anything significant about our variant in these articles. So now, this was just one example of how we would use these articles to annotate our variants. So using all the literature, we assign the attribute of PS3 to this particular variant. Now, let us also look at this particular article. So even in this article, which was there in PMC, there is nothing significant about the variant. Let us now look at one of the other assays that could be present in the literature, which is the in vivo assay, which is when the variant is introduced in any of the model organism and the phenotype upon knockdown is then observed. And the phenotype is totally depends on what type of variant it is and what type of change it is supposed to bring about. Now let us look at another example of PS3, which can be assigned using the literature. For this, I will use another variant that was provided in the previous assignment. After annotating the variant with VEP, I found out that the gene name in which it lied in was NLRP12, and this was the cDNA position, and this was the protein change of that particular variant, and this was the RSID of that particular variant annotated by VEP. So what I will do is I will just demonstrate this variant using the RSID. Ideally, I should look at each of these cDNA changes and protein changes, but just in the interest of time, I am searching only with the help of RSID on OMIM. So as you can see, I have directly reached to the part of the page where this particular variant is present. And now we will try to understand. So they say that this particular variant was observed in a heterozygous condition in the parents. And we can read the article in detail by clicking on the plus button that was available on the page. And after reading through the article in detail, I understood that we can assign the PS3 attribute to this particular variant. I concluded that on the basis of this statement, that they transfected the HEK293 cells with the particular variant that we are interested in. And they observed that there was some kind of change that strongly inhibited the NF-kappa beta activation induced by P65. And I concluded that I can assign the attribute of PS3 to this particular variant. You can go through the literature and assign more evidences to this particular variant. One thing we should note is that this article had the variant represented in a very different format, where arginine is written in a three-letter word format. Hence, if we would have searched using the R284X type of annotation, then we would have never reached to this particular article. Hence, it is very important that we use multiple resources such as ClinVar and OMIM. That is what I wanted to demonstrate by this particular search. And let us now look at two other attributes of ACMG, that is PP1 and BS4, which depends totally on the segregation data that is retrieved through case reports. Now, if we look at what is PP1, so PP1 is assigned when the variant segregates correctly in between the affected individuals and the unaffected individuals, or the individuals who do not exhibit any phenotype, do not have the variant or have the variant in heterozygous condition. And BS4 is assigned when the variant does not segregate and is present in homozygous condition in the unaffected individuals or individuals who do not show any phenotype. And in this manner, we can assign this particular attribute to the variants. Now, PP1 can be also assigned in a form of a graded fashion, where simple PP1 is assigned if there is a two-generation family, and PP1M or PP1 moderate evidence can be assigned if there is a three-generation family, and PP1S can be assigned if there are four or more generations in the family and we know the information of many members or all members across different generations. So we will annotate one variant which had a PP1 attribute, and this variant after annotation with VP was found in the NLRP3 gene, and there were multiple transcripts for this particular variant, and we should ideally search through each one of them, and there were multiple protein position on the basis of the transcripts, and this is the RSID of that particular variant. So after searching through literature, as I mentioned for the previous variant, I found that there were two articles which had evidences, and on the basis of these evidences, I annotated this variant to be of PP1S because there were a large family which had this particular variant. And one thing that we should note is that this gene NLRP3 had an alias in name in the form of CIAS1, and this is an alias of this particular gene. So if we know about this, then we would not get confused about if we are referring to the correct gene or not. So we should be aware of such kind of changes. We could do a simple Google search to understand if this is the same gene or a different gene. The next ACMG evidence that we are looking at is PP4, which is also based on the segregation data. To demonstrate this, so first let us understand what is PP4. So PP4 has four important criteria that should be fulfilled. The first, the clinical sensitivity should be high. It should be a single gene disorder. Less than 50% of the variants in the gene should be benign, and the family and the mode of family history and the mode of inheritance should be consistent. So to demonstrate this, I annotated one variant, and this is the gene name, this is the cDNA position, this is the protein position, and this is the RSID of this particular variant. I browsed through the literature using each one of these IDs, and so this particular article had several families which were having individuals affected and with the same variant and with the same clinical phenotype. Also, it fulfilled the other criteria of PP4, that it should be a single gene disorder, the number of benign mutations should be less than 50%, etc. And that is why I concluded that PP4 can be assigned to this particular variant. Now let us now look at some other types of attributes that are based on the allelic effect of the variant or the molecular characterization of the variant. So here we are interested in understanding whether if there is a compound heterozygous variant, whether it is present in the cis condition or in the trans condition. If it is present in the cis condition, it is considered to be healthy and we would assign the attribute of BP2. And if it is present in the trans condition, it is considered to be deleterious, as both the alleles are affected, and we would give the attribute of PM3 to this particular variant. And to demonstrate this, I have picked up one variant from the assignment as that was assigned in the previous week. The gene name in which the variant lied was WNT10A. This was the cDNA position, this was the protein position, this was the RSID, and these are two articles where it was present in the compound heterozygous position along with other variants, and both the variants were present in different alleles in trans in both of these articles. Hence, I assigned the attribute of PM3 to this particular variant. So in the next particular attribute, we are looking at disease association studies between the variant and the disease phenotype. And hence, we are looking at GWAS studies where the association between the variants and the affected individuals and the normal individuals is seen. So here we need to take care that the odds ratio of this particular association should be greater than 5 and the confidence interval should not include 1. If this is the case, then we can assign the attribute of PS4 to this particular variant. If the odds ratio is less than 1, then we can assign the attribute of BP2 to this particular variant. So to demonstrate this, I picked up one variant that is that was present in the gene WNT10A. This was a cDNA position, protein position, and the RSID of that particular variant. And after browsing through the literature, as I mentioned through the steps in the previous slides and in the previous week, I understood that this particular variant had a very high odds ratio and very high confident association with the phenotype, and hence we assigned the attribute of PS4 to this particular variant. The last attribute that is important in ACMG was the BP5 attribute, and to demonstrate this, I picked up this variant which was present in the USH2A gene, and this is a cDNA position, this is the protein position, and this is the RSID of that particular variant. After browsing through the literature, I found out that one of the PMID had mentioned that this particular variant is found in both affected and healthy individuals in large numbers, and hence I assigned the attribute of BP5 to this particular variant. So I hope after this lecture it is clear as to what steps you should follow to identify and mine literature and retrieve articles that are relevant to us and in assigning the ACMG attributes. And this is how you would assign each of these attributes to the different variants and try to annotate them and try to understand what would be the clinical significance of this particular variant. Thank you for your attention.